Hello, everyone. I'm Joanne Farian. Welcome to tonight's Envision San Diego special, Maxed Out. If the housing bubble was the best of times, Americans feeling rich with equity and flush with credit, this may now be the worst of times. The real estate market has crashed, foreclosures are commonplace, and credit card debt is catching up to the country. We are being forced to examine how we spend money, especially money we don't have. Consumer spending is down, the sharpest drop in almost 30 years. We may finally be exhausted from trying to keep up with the Joneses. Tonight, you'll meet people who couldn't stop spending and experts who say we're addicted to shopping. But first, meet the Reyes family, hardworking and down-to-earth, drowning in credit card debt.
You're gonna have to grate it because I'm not eating the big old carrots like that.
It's a little after 5 on a Wednesday afternoon. Denise and Andreas Reyes and their 6 children are making dinner.
You already picked up your Barbies, right?
And cleaning up.
Use the refrigerator water.
There's barely room for all of them to work.
You didn't take out the trash today, huh?
And play in their 3-bedroom house on a busy street corner in National City. By this time, Denise and Andreas have been up for more than 13 hours. They start their day before 4 a.m. Andreas leaves home at 4:30. Everyone else in the family is usually gone by 6 a.m. Andreas works for a medical waste disposal company. Denise works for the local school board. You'd know her as the lunch lady. There are few signs of waste or indulgence in their home. Just this TV and a couple of iPods. But the Reyes have been spending more than they earn for several years. And this spring, when Andreas' hours were cut back at work, it caught up to them.
All they see their 800 numbers, that means they're the credit company, see? We don't answer it. Unknown callers, we won't answer. Unknown 877 numbers, no. Credit, no. You know, Citicorp, it's all credit. People calling. 5 years ago, we refinanced the house and we paid everything. And we just started all over again. Because I thought everything was okay. I was making the full payment. I was making the $150 credit card payment fine on a couple of them. Okay, everything's okay. And then, let's go get something else and go do this and do that. And that's what happened. It was easy.
The Reyes charge new tires for the cars, this TV, clothes for the kids, trips to Knott's Berry Farm and Disneyland, and dinners out at restaurants.
We would go out to a real nice restaurant in Miramar, and I used to give the guy like $25 tip, and they love us. Like, we haven't been in there, though. We haven't been in there. We have not been in there, huh? We haven't been in Chin's in a long time, huh? How long has it been? Like a year, huh?
In the past 5 years, the Reyes amassed 20 credit cards and $42,000 in debt.
It's easy to get. It's easy. Easy. You go to the store, even Walmart. I walk into Walmart and it's tempting, because you know they have somebody there standing there at the front. You want to apply for a Walmart credit? We'll give you this for free. This for free. You know.
They are like 60% of consumers in this country who carry credit card debt, a country that until recently has been giddy with easy credit. Everything will always be all right when we go shopping. Well, you know, everything seemed all right for so long. After all, spending makes the American economy go round. More than 2/3 of our gross domestic product is consumer spending. That means all the shoes you buy, the clothes, the dinners out, add up to a healthy, growing economy. California's economy is the largest in the country, accounting for nearly 8% of the nation's total GDP. In this state, consumers spend more on goods and services than the entire gross domestic product of countries like Canada and Spain. And so, what's the problem?
Okay. My name is Manny Navarro, and I'm a counselor. I'm a credit counselor, a housing counselor, and a bankruptcy counselor.
These days, Manny Navarro is busier than usual, and that's the problem. He counsels people who are maxed out, underwater, in debt, up to their eyeballs. he's heard it all.
We're seeing a lot of people who are having problems with credit cards because they use the credit card to supplement their income because their income wasn't enough to maintain their home. So it's usually couples. A lot of them are younger couples. A lot of people who are self-employed or were self-employed, people who are being laid off or their hours are being cut back. So we're getting pretty much a well-rounded age group.
Subprime mortgages and living beyond our means has caught up with us. When Navarro got into the credit counseling business more than a decade ago, most of the people he saw were in credit trouble because they bought too many luxury items. Today, they're using credit cards for necessities.
All of a sudden, they had a $2,000 mortgage. Now it's $3,000. But their income didn't go up. Their expenses have gone up, but their income hasn't gone up. So the only other place to go to is your credit cards. So what they do is what they used to spend cash on, groceries, gas, utilities, they're using their credit cards for. And they don't have the money to pay down the credit card or pay off the credit card at the end of the month, so they're starting to build larger balances.
Americans have a total of about $970 billion in unsecured revolving debt. In other words, credit card debt. According to industry statistics, 60% of Americans carry credit card balances. The average amount owed varies depending on who's doing the calculations. Some agencies estimate the number to be as high as $9,000. All agree those balances have grown over the decades.
You load a 16-ton, and what do you get? Another day older and deeper in.
When this song was written 60 years ago, credit cards did not exist in America. The song is about coal mines and the owners who paid workers in vouchers and forced them to buy goods from the company store at higher prices. Men had to keep working in the mine just to pay their debt. It doesn't feel much different today. Only now, it's plastic getting us deeper in debt.
And now let's see just how shopping can be fun, real fun, at this modern and convenient shopping center.
The first general-purpose credit card was introduced en masse to California in 1958. Bank of America sent 60,000 of them to people living in Fresno. The experiment did not go well. There was fraud and massive defaults.
It is this holiday season that will decide whether customer traffic is high enough and prices low enough to make selling at a bazaar a successful alternative to department stores and mall shopping.
But by 1980, credit card regulations loosened, banks could charge higher rates, and soon they began turning record profits.
Greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works.
Between 1980 and 1990, the number of credit cards doubled, and the average credit card balance went from $500 to $2,700. Americans shopped, and bank profits grew.
I think in the 80s, people started to spend more than they earned.
Bob Gavin is in the advertising business. It's his job to get consumers into the store.
Well, I think a cynic would say that advertising sells people things that they don't need, don't want, can't afford. But consumers feel good when they buy.
There's never been a better time to get that Mercedes-Benz on your wish list.
Only AT&T has the new BlackBerry Bold, the fastest BlackBerry ever.
The Smart Select Drill and Jigsaw. Smarter tools, better results.
Platinum. Pure, rare, eternal. From Ben Bridge.
There's a piece of your psyche that we're trying to tap into. Whether you have a BlackBerry or an iPhone or a Verizon or a Sprint or an LG, in that whole world, everybody is looking for that tool that helps express themselves. So what we're attempting to do is to give them the feeling that they have solved a consumer, they've solved an individual problem, communication through the phone or through the internet. And so what we're attempting to do is to reach into various, I like to refer to them as touch points or foundation points, that allows consumers to sort of jump over to the other side and say, you know, I'm free now. I don't have to think about that anymore. I've made my purchase, and I made a smart purchase. I got good value.
But when did we begin confusing need with want? Do we even know the difference? A federal government study looked at how spending habits have changed in the last century. In 1901, Americans spent most of their incomes on the necessities of life, nearly 40% of their budget on food, the rest on housing and utilities. Today, thanks to cheap mass production, almost half our income is discretionary. Only 13% of our budget goes to food, and almost half of that is spent in restaurants and fast food chains. But as our standard of living goes up, so does our debt. It seems we have an insatiable appetite for spending.
And nobody's gonna tell me I can't have what I want. I'll go ahead and buy it.
John and Sophie are members of Debtors Anonymous. It's a self-help group based on the same 12-step program as Alcoholics Anonymous. We aren't identifying them because the group promises anonymity to its members. John joined the group almost 3 years ago after accumulating $30,000 in credit card debt.
And what were you buying? What added up to $30,000?
Oh, geez, a lot of things. Household appliances, CDs, stereo. I've got this big stereo at home and I don't need all that stereo. I'd be satisfied with a little Walkman. Big screen TV. Then when it got to the point where I was running out of money, I would use a credit card, go down, take a cash advance out and pay rent or pay for whatever I needed to pay for on credit.
Sophie has a $50,000 home equity loan and a $5,000 credit card debt.
If I needed it, I had no tolerance for waiting or saving. And I had the sense that if I didn't get it now, I wouldn't ever have a chance again. So it was really from a place of this kind of fear all the time. And so the way I assuaged my fear was to go and get something to prove to myself that I could get things. I mean, it was the craziness of it. If I didn't have something and I got anxious about money, I would go out and buy something to kind of go, ha, I can get what I want, see? And then I'd be so anxious. You know, when I would go home, I'd stay in this kind of cloud of vagueness all the time.
What kinds of things were you buying?
I was buying, shoes were very important to me, clothing. And I also think one of the things that was really important to me was time. So I always needed a certain amount of time off. Travel, being able to go a place when I wanted to go someplace. Things for my house, you know, I should have nice things. I should have new carpeting. You know, I should have the screen fixed on my condo. You know, whether or not I had the money to get the screen fixed, you know, I was looking at what it was going to look like rather than what it was going to feel like.
These people have a lot to do with our addiction to spending. The Joneses, the fictitious neighbors introduced in a comic strip nearly 100 years ago. They were never seen, but everyone wanted what they had.
Keeping up with the Joneses, I know they made your life a mess. Bill collectors, tranquilizers, and getting deeper in debt.
I think that people are always, in our culture, envious of what somebody else has. Because maybe that person has solved that consumer problem in a way that they would like to but haven't yet. So just living in communities such as we do here in Southern California, the home of conspicuous consumption, where BMW and Mercedes-Benz sales are the highest in America, where the highest number of per capita pools in America are located, highest incomes, highest housing values, people are always tallying and keeping score, whether you've got a menial job or whether you're a CEO. And however you're able to play that consumer game, odds are you're going to play that. There are very few monks out there these days.
for myself, I've always looked at the grass is greener on the other side. Someone has something that I want. I wish I had that. And I maybe could not afford it by pulling the money out of my pocket or what was in my bank account. But I did have credit cards with thousands of dollars of limits on them. So I was able to keep up with the Joneses to some degree.
I know people that tell me every 2 years I buy a car. Every year I get a new model car. I trade this one and I get a new model car. Trade this one and I get a new model car. Why? Don't you ever want to not have a car payment? Don't you ever want to know what it feels like to have an extra $500, $800 a month in your bank? No, I'd rather have a new car. It's just the way people think, the way people react to these things.
Why are we trying to fill some other void? Why is it we want things?
Our Western world is spiritually bankrupt. And the financial situation is just
an example
or a mirror of what's going on with each of us. We don't have community. We don't know how to sit down with people. We can't tolerate time without the television on. We don't know how to be in our own skins. We don't have a relationship, and we're thirsty and we're hungry, and we're told over and over and over again, you know, like that example you gave about the Discover card, we're told over and over again that this will be the thing.
As far as the Reyes family is concerned, the Joneses have left the neighborhood. No one here is trying to keep up anymore. They're just trying to survive.
I'm going to tell you the difference of when we had money and now that we don't. It's not that we don't have money, but I'm just saying when I used to have money and not worry about spending the credit cards, I used to go shopping after Thanksgiving. I would be gone. 4:30, 5 o'clock, I was gone. The kids would stay with the babysitter. I was gone. See ya. And I would come back with bags and bags and bags. And put them away. Now, ask me, I didn't even look at the specials after Thanksgiving. I didn't even look at any of it. Why? Why would I look at them?
Creditors have started closing the Reyes accounts, increasing their interest rates on some cards as high as 29%. And for the first time in her life, Denise was declined credit at a local hardware store when she was buying sand for her daughter's preschool.
That's when I wanted to crawl under the sand and hide. I was so embarrassed. He was like, well, ma'am, we're going to have to take all the sand back and put it back. I was like, please don't do this. I go, please, can we just wait? He'll be here. We'll be here. Well, he just happened to, you made it, huh? You made it. I think my son wanted to crawl under the biggest rock there, you know, and hide. It was embarrassing because there was a line of people. Everybody was looking at us. Even the 3-4 sales clerks were like, come on, lady.
Across the country, credit is getting harder to get. Credit card limits are being reduced, and consumers are being denied new credit cards. According to the Federal Reserve's monthly report, credit card debt declined by 0.2% in October, a sign banks are giving consumers less credit. And like the Reyes, Americans have been forced or perhaps chosen to spend less. According to the latest government statistics, consumer spending is down almost 4%. That's the sharpest decrease in nearly 30 years.
I think we're finally forced to take a look at our spending and start to make some realizations that I think it forced us to realize that we didn't have to have all those things.
No, I think I've learned. I don't want to do this again. No more. Even if we're okay again, which I know we will be, but I'm not gonna use credit cards anymore. No, I won't do it. No.
After months of stress, Denise Reyes went to see a credit counselor. She talked to Manny Navarro.
Hi, Manny.
How many is on there? Like 15, 26, 30, 40.
You've got 10 accounts on the program.
That's all?
He helped negotiate with her creditors, reducing her interest and monthly payments.
And I just went, talk. Then I threw it in a drawer and I closed it and I was like, I don't want to hear it. And then I don't know.
But you want that to stop, right?
Right.
And
okay,
this is one way of doing it. And the thing is, a creditor, once they talk to you in a day, they can't call you back.
Okay. Oh, really?
So if they can't communicate with you, they're going to keep calling you. It's an auto dialer.
The Reyes will now be out of debt in less than 5 years, instead of 34 years had they continued making only minimum payments. They will also save more than $65,000 in interest.
It feels good. I feel good because now I know exactly what's going to happen and how it's going to happen, and it feels good.
Credit counseling is free. Most credit card companies will give you a referral if you call and ask.
Good morning, this is Manuel.
Manny Navarro's phone has been ringing nonstop, but he's glad to help. You see, he thinks this job is really his calling. He's been there. He lost everything in the early 90s after losing his job and was forced to live in his car with his infant son.
I know how devastating it is. I know how embarrassing it is. And I know how easy it can come by. I know how quickly it can happen. It can just sneak up on you.
The financial indicators tell us spending has slowed down. Our country is officially in recession. Major chains are going out of business. Stores are even bringing back layaway, a plan that doesn't allow you to take your item home until you've paid for it with cash. But human behavior is a complex thing. A 34-year-old security guard was trampled to death by a mob of shoppers looking for a bargain at this Long Island Walmart on Black Friday, just weeks ago. A sign that it may take more than a few bad months for a country addicted to shopping to kick the habit.
Have they reached a point in time where they are going to fall off the edge because they're too top-heavy with too much credit in their bank account? Perhaps, but it will be a short-lived amount of time. Because just as much as the business of America is about business, the business of consumers is about spending. This is America. Americans spend.
If you are one of those Americans who's been in the business of spending and find yourself maxed out, there is help. A credit counselor can help negotiate your debt and your payment with your bank or credit card company, and reputable companies do not charge for this service. We have more tips for you on our website. You can go to kpbs.org/maxed out. For KPBS and Envision San Diego, I'm Joanne Farian. Thanks for watching.
But you're never too old to learn.
Stop worrying about your neighbors and the fancy thing they got. Cause if you do, you'll find a shoe. You're gonna wind up on the spot. Ow!
Don't let the Jones.
Don't let the Jones.
Don't let the Jones
get you down.
Woo!
Oh, down.
One more time.
Don't let the Jones.
Don't let the Jones.
Don't let the Jones get you down.
Trying to keep up too.
Remember that old saying, all that glitters ain't gold. Take heed, don't ignore it until your money tightly hold. Oh, don't let the Jones,
don't let the Jones,
don't let the Joneses
get you down.
Walk
down,
hear me now, now.
Don't let the Jones,
don't let the Jones,
don't let the Joneses get you down. Walk
down.
Keeping up with the Joneses has only made your life a mess. Bill collectors, tranquilizers, and getting deeper in debt.
You better leave the Jones alone.
more time.
You better leave or leave the Jones alone.
Jones has got a new car today.
Hear what you should say.
Seventy-six fine stores in all at the present time, which will expand to approximately 100. The major department store in the center is the magnificent three-story Macy operation.